How you foot?
It's much better. I'm wearing my hard shoes.
Oh, to be sure, you very good. You about 59.
Want to call the regular Board of County Commissioners meeting to order? And we let us all stand for the invocation and the pledge.
Let us pray. Our fathers, we've just got through celebrating the freedom of our country. We thank you so much that we do have the freedom to worship you. We also have the freedom to meet, Lord, that we can discuss things and we can discuss it frankly, Lord, and they do not have this in all countries. And we thank you so much for allowing us to be in this country where this happens. Just be with each one of us who go through this meeting today. Be with each one that's in this room. And God, may we always remember that you are in charge. In your special name I pray. Amen.
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 Place the flag, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Y'all have seen copies of our minutes of our regular meeting. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes aye. Ayes unanimous. Next thing on the agenda is public comments. And first one name I see is Andre Knight, NAACP school merger. May come up.
Good morning. Andre Knight, representing the local branch of the NAACP. I'm coming in the spirit of peace and unity. I am deeply concerned about the climate of the Twin County region. In wake of the race relation all over this country, Rocky Mount, Nash County, Edgecombe County, we are no different than the other cities in this country. We are sitting on a powder keg about to explode, about to create a race war. This county line merger is about power, race, and personality. I asked Commissioner Chairman Belfield, Commissioner Lou Richardson, and Commissioner Mary Wells to stand your ground. The people admire you for the political courage you have taken while you are in the minority in your position. Please don't compromise your position on county line merger. I believe this is driven by one commissioner who has made $18 million off the Nash Rocky Mount school system and over $8 million on projects in Rocky Mount. Now this commissioner is anti-Rocky Mount. So goes Rocky Mount, so goes Edgecombe County and Nash County. Please help us save our school, save our city, save our region, save our superintendent, most of all, save our children. Please, I'm asking the three of you to rescind your vote. Do not propose or support no final compromise that would resolve the funding on July the 7th that seek legislation to destroy us. Please stand with the city of Rocky Mount, Edgecombe County, both board, Nash Rocky Mount School Board and Edgecombe County Board, to not destroy our system. We're dependent on you. In the event that this happened, we would admire you for the courage that you have taken and that you're united with almost three boards and majority of the people in both regions. Please don't destroy our school system. Don't destroy our city. Don't destroy our children. And don't destroy our superintendent. Again, I thank you. I'm asking you to please rescind your vote. Please do not vote on any legislation on July the 7th that would destroy our region. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Bronson Williams.
I want to say good morning to each of you. I'm, as you said, I'm Bronson Williams. And also I want to talk this morning about the county line divide, because it's not a merger. It is dividing the city of Rocky Mount between Nash and Edgecombe County. I'm actually a product of the Nash Rocky Mount school system in that I live in the Edgecombe County side. So this is deeply rooted and a deep concern for me. However, this morning I'm a bit confused whether or not this board is the Nash County Commissioners or the Nash Rocky Mount School System. This County Commissioners board has gotten its hand really entrenched in the education process and trying to take a more forceful approach at it, which I think is a great disrespect to the people who elected those school board members. They elected the county commissioners to do a job, and that's what you should be doing, and let the school board do what it's supposed to do. In fact, over the couple of weeks, these last couple of days, we heard of the forced resignation of our superintendent. There are those who believe that this board and the special interest that sits thereof has some concern with Superintendent Anthony Jackson. And I hope that today maybe you would clarify that as well. As Mr. Andre Knight just said, we ask that you would rescind your vote on dividing Rocky Mount, North Carolina. This is something really that's gonna cost the taxpayers of Nash County more money. I believe that many of you ran off creating jobs for Nash County. When you decide to push legislation to divide the city of Rocky Mount further to secede from Edgecombe County, as they did when the South seceded from America some years ago, when you do that, you're losing jobs in our community. Teachers will lose jobs. Bus drivers will lose jobs. The need for perhaps substitute teachers will lose jobs. And from your own information, you talked about it costing about $1.7 million and more money for Nash County to have to educate a smaller amount of children. If it's really about the children, you would leave the school system as it is. If it's really about the children, you would increase funding without people having to fight for more funding, if you're really about the children. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Next, Nehemiah Smith Jr.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Nehemiah Smith Jr. and I am too here about the issue of county line split. There seems to be an agenda at work here that is attempting to push the wishes of one person. It is disheartening to know Ms. Wells, Mr. Belfield, and Ms. Richardson would seemingly not vote their conscience and vote with the majority here to go along with this county line split. It is one of the most asinine things that I've had the opportunity to even consider, in that ultimately you're saying that less than 2,000 students is a burden on a system of 16,000. I'm not understanding that, especially when you look at the fact that any monies that are not paid by Edgecombe County are made up by the city of Rocky Mount. But then the argument is made, well, Nash County is a part of Rocky Mount also, so because those funds are there, then we are even paying even more money. But ultimately, when I look at this board, at this particular board, there seems to be a conflict of interest there also, in that you vote on funds to be given to the Nash Rocky Mount school system, and yet you have a commissioner that does work. in the Nash Rocky Mountain school system and has made over $18 million out of $40 million that they spent. That seems to be a conflict of interest to me. And I think you all do have a provision about conflict of interest on your board, is that right? I think so. So for me, that stinks to high heaven. I have a serious problem with that, and that no one has ever brought that up. That Mr. Davis's company does work with the system.
No.
Well, okay. Well, I mean, it is what it is. I know it's not you, Mr. Belfield. I'm going to be frank. All this pussyfooting around the issue is foolish to me.
We don't allow names.
Yes, sir. Well, one of your commissioners.
But you can say what you want to say, but don't be.
One of your commissioners. One of your commissioners does work for the Nash Rocky Mountain School System. A commissioner to my left.
You make your comments.
Yes, sir.
We don't.
So I didn't call a name. I just said to my left, to my far left. So there, you know, I think that it, you know, for us to be pussyfooting around the issue and not addressing it to where it is, I think that's crazy. And I also think it's crazy for this board to push county line split over less than 2,000 students. I don't get that. After the people in Edgecombe County have paid their monies to help you build a new high school in Nash County. So hopefully you will rescind your vote as Mr. Williams asked. Hopefully you rescind your vote as Mr. Knight asked. I don't know what you will do, but I pray that you will have a change of heart and do what's right by all the people. Thank you.
Thank you. According to the sign-up, that concludes our public comments. I'll pass it down to the clerk.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
I realize that I'm not supposed to respond to public comments, and I won't do that this morning.
Yes,
what I would like to do is ask the three gentlemen to speak, if they would be willing to meet with me privately, and I don't care how many of you it is, but of course I think you know your facts are not correct. I'd like to be able to sit in front of the three of them and go over what the facts are, and I'm hoping they would understand the process a little better. And these are the facts about my company personally. I won't get into matters that this board deals with, but I'd give you an open invitation. Mr. Knight, you have my phone number to call me. I'd be tickled to meet with all three of you at any point, any time, and maybe you can help me find that $18 million that I made would be hopefully come out of the process. But I would like to go over the facts with you, and at least let's talk about the facts and not talk about things that are incorrect. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and I'm going to conclude.
And for the record, I would say that I do not do work for Nash Rocky Mountain School Systems. Thank you, sir. I understand.
You said, okay, I'm concluding the public comments.
Thank you, sir.
At this point. And we will move on with the agenda. First thing, next on the agenda is a resolution related to the depletion of Southern Flying, and I'll call on Patsy McGee.
We are here today to hold a public hearing and consider adopting a resolution of support for the NC Division of Marine Fisheries to use the supplement process to quickly limit the harvest of southern flounder or possibly take another position. Regarding the memo, please strike the words legislation related to, as I am unaware of any legislation related to this item.
Where is that, Ms. McGee?
At the very top under item.
Oh, okay. Public hearing
legislation
related to depleted supply of southern flounder.
Just let it say public hearing depleted supply of southern flounder. That was the way it was originally intended.
Thank you.
Well, sorry that we made that error.
That's fine. There is a limited supply of fish, including the most popular recreational fish, southern flounder, which is now depleted per the NC Division of Marine Fisheries. Commercial fishing takes 80% of the stock, leaving 20% for recreational fishing and replenishing the supply. I have come to understand, not being a fisherman myself, that southern flounder is one of the most economically important commercial and recreational fishes in North Carolina. Stock assessments completed by the Division of Marine Fisheries in 2004 and 2009 determined that southern flounder stock was overfished. And since the adoption of the Southern Flounder Fishery Management Plan in 2005, numerous management actions were put in place intended to end the overfishing and rebuild the stock. In 2014, a new stock assessment was completed for southern flounder in North Carolina waters, and it was noted that a high fraction of the harvest consisted of immature fish. These concerns are prompting the Marine Fisheries Commission to consider pursuing a supplement to reduce catch of southern flounder by no less than 25% and no greater than 60%. The supplement process is a temporary, fast-acting mechanism to address an urgent issue before the usual five-year scheduled review of a fishery management plan. So catch reductions were estimated for at least five proposed management options, which would include a season closure, which might be like a month of December or maybe more, increase the minimum size limit of the fish that are caught, say from 14 inches to 15 inches, or decrease the recreational bag limit, meaning possibly six fish, I think, per day per person are allowed now, so reducing that, or various combinations of these items. There are two methods provided for in the general statutes for the Marine Fisheries Commission to take action to address this resource issue and restore the supply. The amendment process would take about 2 years and allow the stock to become dangerously low, according to some. The supplement process would be much quicker and would allow the Marine Fisheries Commission to take immediate action as soon as its August meeting. Why is this issue important to Nash County? Well, the issue could be important for economic reasons. Visitors travel through and support our local businesses by purchasing goods and services on their way to the coast at fuel stations, restaurants, boat dealers, tackle shops, etc. Also, 8,700 Nash County citizens hold recreational saltwater license, well, in 2013, compared with 12 commercial licenses, with only one of those selling fish. Last month, the board decided to hold a public hearing. We advertised in mid-June in the Rocky Mount Telegram, the Nashville Graphic, and the Spring Hope Enterprise for the public hearing today. And also prepared a resolution that requests that the Marine Fisheries Commission support the use of the supplement process by the Division of Marine Fisheries to implement reduction in the harvest of southern flounder so that the fishery is revived. This particular resolution was modeled after Johnston County, which was recommended to us by Lewis Daniel, the director of Diener's Division of Marine Fisheries. But also we had several other copies. We sort of combined them. And if you approve it, I'd be happy to submit it for their consideration. At this time, we need to hold the public hearing.
Well, before I call for a public hearing, I ask any commissioners if you have any questions you want to ask Patsy.
I have one. I think it should be fully explained better and tell us what we're voting for or against or why we're voting this way. That's the only two things I'd say, like to say. That be explained. I doubt that everybody in here knows exactly what they're talking about in each one of these phases. Could you please explain that to us a little more? Somebody, everybody knows what they're talking about.
I probably went into a little more detail than was necessary, and Nash County would not obviously be making any decisions about the fate of the southern flounder. Ours is simply a recommendation to the Marine Fisheries Commission to consider the supplement process, which has been said would restore the supply quicker than using the normal method of the amendment process.
And you're talking about 6 months or 2 years?
That's right, according to Mr. Daniels.
Mm-hmm. Do you know the jurisdiction of the state of North Carolina as far as out into the Atlantic, how far they have the state as jurisdiction of regulating?
I don't know how many miles they go out.
I think it's 20 miles, but I'm not 100% sure.
Somebody else might know that.
3 miles in the back there.
3 miles?
3 miles.
Okay. All right. That's very, very small, but anyway.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Where did this come to us from? Who brought this to our board?
I did.
Missing Outlaw.
And where did it derive from?
I was contacted by a local individual, and he asked that I consider this. Knowing very little about it, I asked Ms. McGee to do some research. She has done a fine job. There are two processes that are available in order to try to restore this particular fish. In population. One of them is the supplement process. The other is an amendment process. The amendment process is about 2 years down the road. The supplement process is my understanding that is something that would be acted on probably in August. So we're not 6 months down the road. We're pretty close to that. It seems like a reasonable thing to do. We have recreational fishermen in Nash County. But by and large, we have thousands of just everyday, we have 8,700, I think, recreational fishermen, but we have, I think, only one active person in Nash County that does this to support his livelihood. So it just seems to me like in order to accomplish the support of the people that do this for a living, not only here, but in other counties, that it would be a good thing to consider. I would like to hear what some of the individuals from the public have got to say about it, if there's any input at all. I asked for the public hearing. I don't think a public hearing was required, but I wanted to hear from the people, which is generally what I want to do, is hear what they've got to say. Because contrary, and I'm gonna just kind of slip this in at this time, contrary to what some people may believe, I am driven by one thing, my constituents. Nobody on this board drives me, and I think it was pretty obvious during the Sanderson Farms process, and I hesitate to even bring that up, but I'm driven by what I think is right for the people of Nash County. And I'm gonna be honest with you, I believe every member on this board is driven by that same thing.
Okay, one more question. Well, it's not a question, but I think we discussed it the other day when we talked about it, about our commercial fishermen. If we did a quickie, which I would say within that 6 month period, I won't use the word damage, but it would certainly limit the commercial fishers. What impact, have you picked up on any information on what impact that would have on them?
It's unclear to me which way the commission might lean in terms of limiting the fishing and how much it would affect the commercial fishermen. I think there, it seems there would be possibly more of an impact on the recreational fishermen, but certainly a season closure, say closing for a month or something, might affect the supply. And also, if they increase the size limit, my understanding is there might be some changes in the nets and that kind of thing that would allow the smaller fish to be free and the larger fish to be caught. It's not clear to me which way they're going to go with this or how much impact our resolution would have or not. I don't know.
That's one thing that should be considered. And I know recreation is mighty important also. So somewhere, I don't know, it needs to be a balance between the two. But anyway, we'll move on with public hearing and let's see what we get. I'm ready for a motion that we go into public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Outlaw, seconded by Commissioner Bond. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes unanimous. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are now in a public hearing. And we ask you, anyone that want to speak for or against, come up and give your name and your address, and you may speak.
I'm Ken Kraft, and I live at 180 Pebble Drive in Nashville, here in Nash County. And yeah, the first thing I'd like to say to you is that I appreciate that the Nash County Commissioners are actually concerned about what might be going on with a fish 100 miles from Nash County. So that's a good thing, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you about it. I've got a little bit of experience with this kind of thing, but my suggestion to you, the board, is that you support the supplement where the North Carolina Marine Fisheries can immediately take action to protect this fish. In our lifetime of all of us, we have seen the striped bass fishery almost depleted in the Roanoke and the Tar River Basin. And as a result of our leadership cutting back the commercial fishing altogether in the inland waters and cutting it back in the coastal waters, we have seen this fishery restored just recently. And so I would ask that the Nash County Board of Commissioners support the supplement or the supplemental process and allow the North Carolina Marine Fisheries to work immediately. These are the people that we have hired as experts and know the most about the resource, and they should be the ones that are making the majority of the decisions about how the fish is managed. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak? Anyone else wish to speak? Seem like that is it, so I entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Davis, second, who was that? I thought, Commissioner Wells, that we close the public hearing. You've heard that motion? All in favor of it, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed at the same sign. Ayes unanimous. Public hearing is now closed. And now I'm ready to entertain a motion to accept this resolution that has been prepared by Patsy or denied.
Mr. Chairman, I offer a motion that we approve the request.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Richardson, seconded by Commissioner Outlaw, that we accept this resolution.
Question, Mr. Chairman.
Any discussion?
My only thought is, if somebody could help me, how would we look at this different than the several other items that's been before this board recently concerning hunting more than fishing? And of course, Mr. Chairman, you indicated last meeting you didn't like to take no action on something. I understand that comment. But is there any distinct difference in what we got here today versus what we chose not to take action on several others? And, of course, I'm a little bit closer to this one. If my father was still living, I didn't vote for it. I probably couldn't go to his house for dinner anymore. Being he gigged Flander all his life. But what is the difference of what we have here? Can we find any distinct difference that would make me feel good about voting for this one?
Well, when I said take no action, we were having a public hearing.
Correct.
And we've had.
Yep.
And
didn't have any opposition.
We only had one person to come up and speak. No one spoke against the supplement.
Right.
So that's the difference.
Gotcha. Thank you.
And we have had some that we didn't take an action on.
Right.
But
appreciate it, Mr. Chairman.
But you have a commissioner that's recommending that we do.
Yep.
And now we have a motion on the floor, and I'm going to call for the question. All in favor of the motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed, the same sign. As unanimous.
Thank you.
Nancy. UDO text amendment related to internet sweepstakes. CAFS.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning we have an item to conduct a public hearing to consider a text amendment to the UDO requirements currently for Internet Sweepstakes Cafe. And that the request involves reducing the required separation between a cafe and a residentially zoned lot. Nash County first adopted zoning regulations related to Internet Sweepstakes Cafes in 2010. They are allowed with certain development standards in rural commercial and general commercial districts in the county. The current ordinance requirements are listed in your packet, and you'll notice that they involve property separation, which is Section C, property separations of 500 feet for both, in terms of residents, 500 feet from a residentially zoned lot, and there's a requirement that it also be located, not located within 500 feet of an existing residence. The proposal or the request that's the subject of a public hearing today is a request just to diminish or reduce the separation distance from the residentially zoned lot from 500 feet to 385 feet. And the applicant is Joseph Bass. Just to give you an example or a picture of what that would look like, we put this together. It does not have the zoning boundaries on here, but the zoning boundary actually goes like this. What you can see here is if a location were to be, an internet cafe were to be located in this part of, this is a shopping center, if this part of a shopping center, then the current 500-foot boundary is the outer red line, and the proposed boundary of 385 feet is represented by the inner circle. So where these hash lines here are shown, those would be the basically the reduction or the area that would be affected by the change. In this particular example, because there are not any actual residences located within those yellow hash lines, then it would be allowed if the reduction were to be approved, because it would reduce the separation distance required to that inner circle from the outer circle. In a different example, had this house been located here, then that would, the house would have to be located within the, let's see, if a house had been located within this internal 385-foot difference, distance, then that would stop the project from being located at that site as well. But in this case, the applicant is just requesting a change in the zoning district separation. Okay. Also, just since we've had these regulations, the staff has been approached a number of times. I can think of four different locations in different parts of the county that have been inquired about to possibly locate an internet sweepstakes. In each one of those instances that have been brought to the staff, and some of those locations have been visited, have been inquired about on more than one occasion. In each case, either the 500-foot separation distance based on the zoning district or the 500-foot separation based on the existence of a house, an existing house, has prevented those operations from being approved. Okay. So that's the impact of our current regulations. There is, to my knowledge, an operating, because the towns have different regulations regarding internet sweepstakes cafes. There may be some located in the towns. I believe there is one operating in Nashville. I'm not sure if there still are any in Rocky Mount or not, but the towns may have different regulations than the county. But currently in the county, to our knowledge, there are not any operating sweepstakes operations.
Rosemary, may I ask you a question? What is the difference in between what we have now in our towns now, what we got in these?
Did you finish your presentation? And then I'm gonna let you ask the question.
Oh, okay, do whatever you please.
Okay, yeah, but that's the difference that's being requested this time is the difference from the zoning boundary. The TRC heard this proposal and reviewed this amendment request. I'm sorry, I forgot to indicate about the land development, the conformity with the land development plan. Because the commissioners have already indicated by determining the development standards that a sweepstakes cafe would be an acceptable permitted land use in commercial zoning districts with those standards that are currently in the ordinance, then a change in your determination, any change in your determination of what an acceptable distance would be would still be considered to be in conformity with the land development plan. The TRC reviewed the proposed text amendment on May the 28th and recommended denial. The planning board also considered the proposed amendment at its regularly scheduled meeting on June 16th. They recommended denial based on the following determination. The currently required 500-foot separation distance between an internet sweepstakes cafe and a residentially zoned lot was intentionally and specifically established by the Board of Commissioners in order to protect the interests of the county's residential properties, property owners, and the existing regulations continue to effectively accomplish that goal.
Have you completed your...
Yes, sir.
Okay. Commissioner Morgan, now you ask the question.
I was going to ask you, what is the difference between the existing ones that we have now and what we are trying to plan to do? What is the difference in the two?
The difference
some
is
of the
what
towns, some of the towns have them now and already in them.
Right. This would have no impact on what the towns do, only in Nash County. But the difference would be that it would be reduced, the distance that you have to have between a residentially zoned property, an R40 or an R30, for instance, and a commercial, and the location of an internet sweepstakes would be reduced from 500 feet to 385.
The towns get a tax, not a tax, but a break with it when they got it in the cities. Too, some of the cities have a tax that they get money they get from whatever use that has created, and it comes back to the users, out to the place that owns the thing. That's my only thing that I see in the difference.
I believe that there are some differences in what towns can do, maybe, than what the counties, what the counties can do, or what the counties have done.
But they're really the same thing, aren't they? Mainly about the same thing as this, the difference of each segment of the town that's going to get the tax back out. Someone get some tax money back out of it. But anyway, That's a lot of them have it. A lot of the towns did it. But anyway.
Commissioner.
What are the business hours, normal business hours on these, you know, sweet soaps, cafes?
It would depend on the individual business hour development standards. Double check, but I don't think they typically don't involve business hours of operation, so it would depend on the individual business.
Any more questions by board members?
I don't see any difference between the two and what it brings, if it brings any tax money back to the counties or the states or the towns. The towns ought to get a little something out of it by doing it. Some of them get a whole lot out of it. It'd be a detrimental to them to be able not to get that tax to go in there. So I don't see what the cut it off would be, how good it would be. But anyway.
With what you're saying, you in favor of reducing it, the number of feet?
No.
Okay. All right. Well, okay, let's go into public hearing. I'm ready for a motion that we go into public hearing.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Davis.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Barnes. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed to the same sign. As unanimous. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now in a public hearing on UDO text amendment related to internet sweet steak calves. Come up, state your name, and your position, where you're for or against.
Good morning.
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 My name is Janice Thompson. I live in Edgecombe County, but I have a daughter, son-in-law, and my only two grandchildren live in Nashville. And we would like to open up a business here. We went to the planning department, printed maps. I know there was like four or five of us. We searched every property in Nash County, and we just couldn't find anything that was less than 500 feet. So I was going to request a text amendment, but somebody else beat me to it. So I just have this one handout. I pass you out. There's four pages and then the full house bill, but I'm just going to go over the first sheet. The first sheet is reasons why 500-foot property separation is detrimental and not necessary. Based on current strict property separation restrictions, there are virtually no existing places for a cafe to open. Many counties in North Carolina have lesser or no property separation restrictions. See attachment. And I have one of the attachments shows some of the counties that do have less than 500. Respectable people go to cafes, with the majority being middle-aged women. There is no consuming alcohol allowed on premises and very little crime in most cafes. In the past 3 years, Clover City Internet Cafe in Farmville only had one incident that resulted in charges. One employee was charged with employee theft. Another incident was one person lost their wallet and another customer picked up the wallet, but since cameras are in every room, we were able to identify the person and the wallet was recovered. House Bill 922 requires a background check before issuing a license to operate video sweepstakes, which basically eliminates people with questionable backgrounds to operate cafes. Sweepstakes have gotten a negative rap in the past, but you only hear about the one or two bad cafes. You never hear about the good ones because they don't make sensational headlines. Nash County will lose thousands of dollars that they can receive when House Bill 922 is passed. Nash County will receive $1,000 per location and $500 per machine. Example, a location with 50 machines would generate $26,000 of additional income for Nash County. Just three cafes with the same quantity of machines would equal $78,000 for Nash County. Nash County will also receive more income from visitors from other counties. People who visit cafes buy gas, food, cigarettes, etc. The more visitors you have in Nash County, the more local revenue that is generated. Due to the strict property separation, Nash County residents have to travel to other counties to spend their money on the entertainment of their choice. Customers enjoy hanging out with friends, drinking sodas or coffee, and socializing. Please reduce the separation requirement. There's three pages attached. One is just some counties with lesser than 500 feet. Two is a picture of, some pictures of the cafe in Farmville, so you can see, you know, what a cafe looks out like, and see it's, you know, it's like any other business. They can donate to charitable organizations. They are a part of the town and what goes on in the town, and you can see, you know, Christmas float. And then the final attachment is just the House Bill page 8 highlighted that shows once it's passed, North Carolina basically is making it where every county does the same thing and charges, because there's been a problem in North Carolina where some counties charge way too high fees and other counties don't charge anything. And so they're just going to make it universal across the board. But thank you for your time. Thank you. Any questions for me?
I have questions.
So do you have, what are your business hours?
In Farmville, we're open 24 hours. We have a lot of people. The busiest time, you know, you have spots come all during the day. But the busiest time, you know, is like from 7 to 2 or 3 in the morning. But usually there's always somebody in the cafe.
So that's 24 hours, 7 days a week?
Yes, ma'am. And our local officers, they come out there all the time and drink coffee with us. And we've never had any problems. Plus, we have real good security. When all the places, you know, when you hear about robberies going on, like in our cafe, and we're at the Food Line Shopping Center, the Chinese place was robbed, Food Line was robbed, Family Dollar was robbed. We were the only place in the whole section that weren't robbed because of our security.
What type of security do you have? You have people there? I mean,
well, to enter, to come into the front door, you have to ring the bell. And, you know, you can't be wearing a hoodie or anything. And so if the cashier doesn't know the person coming in the front door, the standard procedure is they're supposed to go into the office and shut the locked door. They also have a panic button, so, you know, because they are open during the night. So if anything was to happen, they could press the panic button. And we have a camera in every room. There's a camera on the outside of the entrance, camera in the back of the building, camera on the side of the building. Matter of fact, because of the robberies in the strip mall, it was the officers, police officers, sheriff asked us to, police chief asked us to install cameras on the back of the building and the side of the building so we could help them catch the people who were robbing the other stores. But we had the only place in the building you go to that you're not on videotape is the bathroom.
May I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
What kind of tax does the towns draw from them? Each, some of them that have some, give me a, if you got an example of two or three different ones, what kind of tax do they draw to the state?
Last year, Farmville, I know the town manager, he told me they made $60,000 off the three cafes. There's two cafes, well, there's three cafes in Farmville now. That's my question. And that was a lot of income for that little town.
Ms. Thompson, are you saying you could not work in this facility as it is designated without this improvement, as it is right now?
Right now, the property, the picture of the location on the map, because it's the residential zone property is within the 500 feet, we can't operate there unless it's...
Why?
Because of the rules y'all have. The rules and the property separation rules prevents a cafe from opening there. And so I don't know why, you know, cafes are treated like they're so bad. They're just like any other business.
Okay. Well, thank you for your presentation. It seemed like there's no more questions. Okay, anyone else wish to speak? For or against? Anyone else wish to speak? For or against? All right, I'm ready for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Wells, second by Commissioner Richardson, that we close the public hearing on the internet sweepstakes cab, a text amendment. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed is the same sign. As unanimous. I have one question, Nancy. It was denied by the Technical Review Committee and is also denied by the Planning Board. Was that unanimous?
I believe
yes.
Both. Yeah, I believe the Planning Board. Yes, both of them were.
Both of them unanimous.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I remember when we put the 500 feet in there, we were looking at all entities that we think of, and I know churches played a big role in that. And to change this means that it would be countywide, not specifically for that particular area.
Correct.
Am I right on that?
Correct.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Everybody understand
that? Are you saying this is countywide that we're going to put enforcement on like this?
Yep, to change, amend it from 500 feet to what, 385. It's got to be countywide.
And you got to be 300 feet, at least 300 feet countywide.
385. You change. If you prove it, you're changing from 500 feet to 385 feet.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
The current UDO establishes standards for these type cafes. Those standards were established intentionally and specifically to protect the residents. And based on that, I still stand behind.
Churches and residents.
Exactly. I stand behind that decision we made in our UDO, and therefore I move for denial and move that we adopt consistency statement B.
There's a motion on the floor now to deny. The TRC.
TRC and the Planning Board both unanimously.
Both denied it. Okay. All right. You've heard that motion. Ready for the question?
Need a second.
That's, I'm sorry. Motion by Commissioner Outlaw, seconded by Commissioner Richardson. Any more discussion? All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed to the same sign, ayes unanimous, the ordinance still stands.
You need to also, motion number two, recommending denial of the text amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we recommend denial of the text amendment.
Motion by Commissioner Outlaw that we deny the text amendment, and who seconded?
I did.
And seconded by Commissioner Richardson. You've heard that motion. Any discussion? All in favor of it, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed is the same sign. Ayes unanimous. Nancy, I believe you had something else you wanted to cover before you.
I did. I have one thing that was not on your agenda in your package. You remember last month we had a hearing regarding a grant request, a CDBG grant request, for a new program called the Commerce Fellows. And I wanted to let you know two things about that grant application. One is that we received a notification earlier this month that Nash County had been awarded one of those Commerce Fellows capacity building grants. And they're on a very quick turnaround. I think at your places, I left you a copy of the approval letter, the grant letter, and also a kind of a roster on the back of the officials and county and town staff that will be attending those in-person classes. You'll remember that this grant award was for what they call capacity building, and it's for tuition and lodging and mileage, and anyway, those fees, those charges associated with sending some staff to training, and the recommendation in the grant application, excuse me, was that counties would partner with towns. And so there's a both in-person classes where you go to the School of Government in Chapel Hill and attend specific classes, and then there's also a series of things that will be done online here hosted by Nash County. So I just wanted to let you know that we have been awarded that grant, and because of the class schedule, they're on a very quick turnaround to try to get those grant documents approved and submitted back so we get the conditions released. And they're asking us to return those documents back by July the 27th, which is before your next scheduled commissioners meeting. And so what I would ask the board for is authorization, of course, to accept this grant award from the Department of Commerce, and also to authorize the county manager or the chairman, whichever is appropriate depending on the document, to execute those standard CDBG documents and be able to get them back by that submittal date of July the 27th.
All right, fellow commissioners, we have been awarded a $25,000 community development block grant, and basically this is what, training?
Yes.
And I think that's something that we ought to take advantage of. Any discussions on this letter that I received from the Department of Commerce?
Mr. Chairman, I think we are very fortunate to have been awarded this effort, and thank you for the county's, Ms. Nixon's efforts in this endeavor. And we all know we all need more training, so with that said, I will move for approval of this request.
Second.
Moved by Commissioner Richardson and seconded by Commissioner Davis that we accept this great opportunity for Nash County and municipalities. All in favor of that motion? Let me ask first, any more discussion?
That includes authorization to execute those documents, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
All in favor of the motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And opposed, the same sign. Ayes unanimous.
Thank you.
You don't need to do any signing now, do we? We can do that later?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. At this time, I'm going to call for a 10-minute break.
What you got in your hand?
Call the meeting back to order. Rosemary.
Good morning.
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 Morning. As you know from last month, this item, land purchase from Elm City, is a carryover. At the last meeting, we held a public hearing on this item where the town of Elm City is proposing to purchase a couple of tracts just inside Nash County. And per the statutes, they're required to request approval from you to do that. At the last meeting, we conducted a public hearing, and the town and adjoining property owners were instructed to meet and talk about the issues they have and hopefully work them out. I'll leave a map up here of the property. And think Mr. Russell, the town administrator, is here to make some remarks about the conversations they've had with property owners. Any questions for me?
Any questions? If not, Mr. Russell.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks again for allowing me to come back. Again, it's in regards to the property at 6432 Homestead Road in Elm City. A portion of this lies within Nash County jurisdiction. We're seeking the approval of the purchase of the property in accordance with state statute that would allow for the expansion of our wastewater treatment spray field and lift the current sewer moratorium. Following the last meeting, we've had meetings with the individuals that voiced some concerns at the previous public hearing. We were able to work through some of those issues, not all, but some. And I brought Mike Myers today. He operates our spray field. He's the owner of EnviroLink, which is a Nash County-based company, for some more technical response. But I'll allow him to elaborate more on the processes and the spraying that will take place on this property that we're requesting approval on. I'll just turn it over to Mike.
Thanks. After after last month, we went back, and as Jonathan indicated, we met with the two individuals that had voiced some concerns, and after hearing their concerns and working with them, we've gotten some additional information, and that has helped us to kind of be able to refine our plan a little bit better and how we might address some of the concerns that we heard and still meet the needs of the town. And so, as Jonathan indicated, asking for your approval to purchase the land, but from a technical standpoint, our intent would be on this next expansion to only spray within those areas that Wilson County has jurisdiction on, and not be spraying in the portion where Nash County has jurisdiction. If in the future, we think that'll probably carry the town for several years, but if in the future there was ever a need to spray on the Wilson or in the Nash County portion of where Nash County has jurisdiction, we would come back to Nash County and we'd be required to get a special use permit. And so you'd have the ability to either approve or deny at that point in time in the future if that ever did happen. So, with that, I guess if there's any questions, happy to answer any questions.
Would there be a requirement for a special use permit? I'm not aware of any requirement. I'm asking our planning director.
Our ordinance would not currently provide it. The board could certainly initiate a text amendment to add that.
But currently, there's no requirement for a special use permit. That was my understanding as well.
Certainly would be willing to make that a condition of your guys' approval for the land purchase.
I have one question for you, if I would. It's not the size of the land that they want to spray it on. It's the return that it gets out of it that affects the people around it. That's what bothers me about the whole thing. What is it? They spray it on the ground, and then they it goes to your house, my house, or everybody's house in there because the smell will go there. It has to, another choice. But the smell that you have, that he sprays it on that land, because I've seen it done before, and it sprays it on that land, and it don't go away in many years sometimes.
Yes, sir. And we understand the environmental concerns. There are currently 5 permitted spray fields that are in operation within Nash County that we've checked, verified with the state on. And they're monitored by the state, and we make every effort to stay in compliance with all the environmental concerns that are out there.
And I will say it would have to go through state permitting before anything would be allowed to be done out there. The state is aware, Diener, Department of Natural Resources is aware of what the town's intent is. They at least conceptually approve of this direction by the town.
And basically what we're seeking just for the first phase is the approval of the purchase according to state statute. This doesn't approve any type of spray action or whatnot. We have several other steps to go through, but the initial phase, we would need approval from Nash County.
You're required to treat that water before it's put on spray for you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Shouldn't have that much odor. if it's properly treated.
Are you, let me ask you a question while you're talking to him about it. How many of us know what the spray, after the spray field, when he sprayed on there, what it's going to do to you, or what it harms you, or whatever, at this time? The smell don't go away, not in 30 days. If you don't treat the water, it'll make it so it won't go on there. I think we should do little things once in a while for the people out there that it affects, not what you're putting on the ground. But it's for it. Well, you can't do away with that smell. Not right now. You can't do it. And it's, don't do anything that'll harm your neighbor. But however that may be.
And so, yeah, and that's why we've kind of pulled back. If you'll notice, we've pulled back. Where we would be spraying would be much further away from the Tyson property and from the other property that was in question. So if you'll see, last month when we were here, we were talking about, we were talking about roughly this line right in here, with the Tyson's property being over in this area here. So now we're talking about pulling that back and only spraying in this area down in here, which this is where Wilson County has their jurisdiction. So we've increased that buffer between the homes, the residents, the concerned citizens, and where we would be spraying to give more distance between them.
Was Mr. Tyson okay with that?
I would be misrepresenting if I said he was. He is still concerned, would be my yeah. comment to you.
But I've talked to him several times since he met, so yes, I think I know exactly where he is. He's not here today because his family's on vacation.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I believe Mr. Tyson Jr. had a few more concerns. Mr. Tyson III, we walked through the environmental concerns with him, and I think they have just agreed to disagree between the two of them. But
well, that's not totally correct, because I received some information from Mr. Tyson III.
Yes, sir.
And to clarify, I communicated back with him.
Yes, sir.
And I got a very strong email back that they're both very much in agreement and the opinions have not changed.
Okay.
And I think this followed a meeting that you had with Wilson County residents out in the area. So I think, maybe they were aware of that.
Oh, yes, sir.
I just want to say, as the mayor of the town of the city, and I've been there for a long time, ever since we got on the moratorium in 1998, and we've been working with Diener and the people from Raleigh, and they have been helping us put together, along with our engineer, a plan to probably help us get off the moratorium. So we're doing everything we can, and I know that you guys will want to support any community that's working hard to try to get off the moratorium. You know what that's like. You cannot grow, cannot do anything. I promise you, they are not going to let us do anything that's going to be wrong or that's going to benefit, that's going to hurt any citizens or anybody in the community. Because their standards are so very high, and we have to meet those guidelines and regulations. So I know y'all guys are aware of that, because y'all have spray fields in your county that y'all that they had to be accountable for. And we have to be accountable for everything we do, whether it's Wilson County or any other county, to do the right thing. And I feel if we do the right thing and do it the way it should be done, according to the regulations, I think everything will be fine.
Do you have any options other than this particular land? Any options at all to remove this moratorium?
There are other options. I would put them as not being economically practical for
so
the
it's
town.
A funding
yeah.
matter.
Mm-hmm.
So there are other options that just cost more money for that land versus this land.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
But is that land in Wilson County?
It would not be. When I say other options, it would not be land purchase. It would be other.
Well, I understand you have some options. Possibly you're looking at connecting to Sharpsburg, to Rocky Mountain, to Wilson, and that sort of thing.
Right.
But is there land available in Wilson County in close proximity to where you are now that would accommodate this purpose? I've been told it is.
We did purchase another piece of land that's in Wilson County that's going to help us as far as getting off the moratorium. That's why we figured that we won't have to use very much of this. This would probably put us in compliance. Not the whole set that we're trying to buy, but we're thinking the Wilson County part that we would have to develop would probably help us with what we already got to get off the moratorium.
Well, I'm not a lawyer, and I just ask some dumb questions sometimes, but would you sign an agreement that you would never, ever put a spray field in Nash County from this particular operation? Would you sign an agreement to that effect? Could you sign an agreement? Because, I think what's going to happen is in time you're going to be forced, in order to relieve this moratorium, to expand out into Nash County with this spray field. And again, Ms. Nixon, I'd like to know, just for my own information, where those other five spray fields are, because I'm going to make it a point to go out, and I want to look at those spray fields as well. Okay. But, I mean, that's just, would you do that?
Obviously, we can't commit for the...
Okay, I know that.
We can't commit the town today.
I understand that. That was kind of a rhetorical question.
But back on the land purchase, we have solicited neighboring landowners, and they have no interest in selling. The piece of property that we're discussing, we've been working prior to my arrival, shortly after the moratorium was put in place. Again, he's a farmer, that's his livelihood, and he was looking for suitable land to find, and that has come about. He's understood our situation. He's wanted to help us, but he wanted to find it.
You're saying that you have looked for that land, and they have turned you down on selling that land?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'd like to speak to good morning. I'm Melvin Cook, Commissioner of Melbourne City. I came on the board in 98 as we were getting on moratorium, and it has really been a hassle us trying to get off of it. We have tried several places to get land and hadn't been able to do it. It was either too high or the state would not approve it.
Wait a minute, let me back up on that. You saying they wanted too much for the land?
Right.
So they offered to sell you the land.
The land didn't look suitable, either too much for the land.
Okay, did they offer to sell you the land? It was just more than you wanted to pay.
It was a whole lot too high.
So the land was available?
A little bit, but not enough. Nothing like what you're getting now.
Well, I've heard otherwise, so I don't know. I'm hearing conflicting stories now.
We were placed on moratorium, and we've been trying to do that since then. We've had a real hard time doing it, and finally, about 7 years ago, I don't know what you're familiar with it, we got 100 acres on 301 that we have a nice spray field on it. If you ride by there, it's right on 301 near the county line. You don't smell it. We got a farmer growing hay on it for his cows, and there will never be a lagoon on this property we're talking about, just a spray field. And with y'all's help and the state and us working together, I think we would be super neighbors, because I don't think you would have any problem as far back as this is with a spray field. And if we don't put that there, who knows what might come up later somebody wants to put there. So I think it would be super for us and good for y'all too, because we're going to have spray field then all the way from 301 to Homestead Lane, which would be good, and it's going to be practical. And one day, Nash County might want some sewage. Let's take some sewage from Nash County. So I think Jonathan told you we've been talking to Sharpsburg and different things we've been talking about to do with it. But
Jonathan didn't tell me that. I got that from the residents, actually.
But it's going...
From the community meeting that you had. They told me some other things from that meeting, too.
But I just wanted to point out that we've been, working on this since 98. It's too high to get the land, and it'd be too high to hook on the Wilson and Rocky Mount. We'd have to go up so high on the water rates and sewage rates. So.
And then the final thing is, we then got to get the money to go in the further as we purchase the land to get the funding to be able to put it into process. So that's going to be another 2 years or maybe longer. Probably getting the funding, because we know how the funding is right now. It's very, very hard to get. You can get loan money, but we can't get too much grant money. So we got to work through that problem. So
that's right.
That's going to be another delay. But I appreciate, as the mayor, I appreciate talking to you.
Yeah, I do too, and I appreciate y'all listening to us. But we've been working so long and just at a standstill again, and we would really love to move forward with it. But I think everybody would see that this spray field is not going to be a bad thing for Nash County. And it would really help Elm City a whole lot. And I thank y'all for listening. And if y'all can help us out, we would certainly appreciate it greatly. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you one more question. It's not the price of the land that's creating the problem. It's the smell that it creates. It's on that land. It's going to be there, and you can't do away with it. How are you going to do away with it?
Well, I know there was some issues in the past with smell, and I think even by the residents' admission that there hasn't been any recent issues with smell that have been noted either by the town or we have not heard of any issues with smell.
But anyway, just like on 301, if you get any smell, the lagoon is right there near 301. This land will not have lagoons.
And I would say the majority of the smell comes from the lagoon.
Right.
The lagoon site itself, and we operate a four lagoon system, and we're not expanding that portion of the treatment plant. It's just spray application. We will just be irrigating the hay field on the new land purchase. There will not be any lagoon expansion.
Only thing I'm saying is for the people around it, that's the problem, because they can't, and it's not fair to us to go out there and put it something on them that will make devalue their property. Put leaf smell that started they can't do away with, because they can't do away with it if they keep the same stuff out there. Anyway.
Well, it sounds like to me that the residents in that area and the property and some of the property owners, do you need more time to do some more work on this?
We would definitely be willing to meet, sit down with the neighboring property owners an extended period. We're on the agenda for Sharpsburg tomorrow. We've spoke with them roughly 3 years ago about possibly doing a joint effort or taking some of their wastewater just to speak with their board. Their mayor didn't feel comfortable about presenting before any sort of board decision had been made. So. I think we would be open to meeting with other landowners if they have any concerns to voice to help walk through the process of what our treatment system consists of and the impact it'll have on their land values and any kind of environmental quality they have in that area.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any questions? More questions?
Mr. Chairman,
what was that?
Just a couple of comments. First of all, I'm very reluctant to just totally deny this request. I guess I am too. My background.
That's why I'm asking.
Right, I understand.
They need more time.
Yeah. My background, having installed many of these wastewater treatment plant irrigation systems in the past, some much larger than what Elm City has. They certainly work. They can work without any detrimental effect on the neighbors as it relates to groundwater quality or as it relates to smells when they're properly operated. The problems come in, of course, when they're not properly operated, just like the car that you drive. If you don't look after it, it's not going to operate properly. I wasn't aware until this came up that an adjoining county had to get permission to buy land at another county. And Vince, is that for any reason or just for something like this?
For any reason. For
any reason.
It only applies to about 60 to 70 counties.
Yeah, right. And I think I can understand why we have that law based on some other things. But yet, I'm not comfortable at all voting and giving up that right as long as we got citizens living in Nash County that are not happy with what's going on. I think the only way I could vote to support it would be once we get our own Nash County residents satisfied that they can live with what may happen. And you know, we can't talk about what we may do in the future, may not do in the future. You gotta refine it to facts, and it's gotta be supported by a document that won't change in the future. You two guys won't be there forever. We certainly wouldn't be here forever. It's just hard to give up a right that somebody in our history has worked real hard to get to give us that right. on an item that has some controversy to it, and some potential doubt of citizens in Nash County that may be harmful for them. It can certainly be done without any harm, but yet it could be done and cause harm when it's not looked out properly. Of course, I'm just rambling, but it's a very complex situation. We could easily vote it down today and say you can't do it, but what that does is what we all talk about all the time. It's not trying to work together with our neighbors, regardless of who they are. And this particular one, been in Wilson, I just think it's important for us to try, Mr. Chairman, every way we can to find a solution where everybody is happy, and I know it can't be done, and if not, we'll just have to deny the request to buy it. But I would like to see if they think they can work it out with these people, but of course, if they can't, I'm willing to vote against it.
Okay. What's your comments on that?
I
agree. I'd like to give more time to make sure that you can work this out with the residents out there and landowners.
And just something that we may be thinking about, maybe to address those types of concerns, something we can take back to the council, and that would it be acceptable, or if there was some type of condition on the approval that said in the future, if Elm City desired to want to spray in Nash County, that there would be some type of approval required by the commissioners at that point in time. Short of an outright saying we would never, because things can happen in the future that none of us can foresee. So I'm just kind of trying to bridge recognizing that and being able to address the concerns.
Well, when we get into text amendments and special uses, it's difficult to us to tie it to one parcel of land in a given county, because once we do a text amendment, it applies throughout the county. So I don't know what the answer is.
Well, my suggestion would be to go back and work. Try to work out a satisfactory agreement with the surroundings, the property owners, and residents out there. And is that agreeable to the board?
I just have one question. I'm reading in your statement here, and it's saying is that the possibility that you would not utilize this in the near future. But is there any way you could maybe sign a document or something saying that you would not spray on it or whatever until we approved it or something? But it has to be something in writing.
I think that would be something. We could enter an
interlocal agreement.
An agreement in place expressly stating what is expected by both parties. I can only assume that the board would.
Well,
to me, that's like buying a golf cart, to use this analogy, and putting it in the yard and saying, I'm just going to drive it around the yard. I'm never going to drive it up the road to see my neighbors. I mean, I don't know who will be sitting on this board in future years. I don't know who will be on your board. But we either would approve it or not approve it. And if we approved it, then you would have full latitude to do whatever the zoning allowed you to do with it. I just don't think that something like that for future years would really work too well. But I agree with the meeting again with the residents, but I do think it would be important, Mr. Chairman, for us to have representation from our Nash County administration or some representation from this board or something at that meeting, because I know what the people that have contacted me, and as a matter of fact, even the people in Wilson County are contacting me. Miss Griffin, I mean, you met with those people the other night, and that whole community watch group is unanimously, she said, against this thing. So I want to work with you too, but I don't want to work with you against my own people that elected me to represent them. And I'm listening to what they're saying, and they're saying, it ain't good for us.
Okay, it's an agreement.
Mr. Williams.
I'm not hearing any.
Mr. Williams has raised his hand, wishing to speak.
Yeah.
Well, we've already had it. Didn't we have a public hearing on this? We have already had a public hearing. I'm gonna let you work that out with Mr. Williams. We've already had a public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, if we've allowed the representatives from Elm City and Wilson to speak, certainly we can allow one of our own citizens a couple of minutes to present whatever he's got.
I agree.
Okay, I'm seeing some heads nodding, so let him speak. So, Mr. Williams, come up and tell us what you want, your concerns.
Appreciate the opportunity to speak to the board again. We had a group of names on a petition last week. Now that has increased to over 95 people in the community, Wilson and Nash County people, that are against the increase in the spray field in Nash County. And we listen to these people talk, and I'm going to take just a very few minutes. These are papers right here I've got that come from Diener, and they want to be good neighbors, and they want to do what's right.
Can you straighten that up, Mr. Williams?
So sir?
Can you straighten that on the screen so we can...
That's just one of them. And they want to enter into agreements, and they want to do what's right and what they agreed to in their agreements. Well, this has to do with the violations that they've had recently. I'm not going to be reading from the same page that you're reading from, but then I'll switch and I'll read from this one. It's two different reports. Wastewater, on the date of inspection, wastewater ponding throughout the air application area, the surface irrigation field was observed to have runoff flowing from the field and discharged into wetland areas adjacent to the north field, north of the field, which ultimately fed into Town Creek. That's one of the violations. Then the numerous spray, this in the same, numerous spray nozzle risers observed to be plugged and did not spray any wastewater. And then another violation, during the inspection, wastewater runoff directly into the wetlands adjacent to the field, noted northern, I just said that areas of broken risers, plugged nozzles, plugged lines, indicate that operators have not adequately noted and addressed operational issues. Photos of these observed are found in the attached report. Neither operators have not adequately observed the system's operations and made appropriate repairs. They have failed to properly report the system by allowing these physical conditions to continue unabated. The operators have failed to adequately distribute wastewater application to the entire field and allowed overloads in large portions of the field. That was in January of 2015. March 26, 2015. Due to persistent and unresolved infiltration area into the town's collection system, I want to put in the back of your mind, is land their issue? It says ponding continues to be observed in substantial areas of spray field, and application reports indicate the considerable runoff. Additional numerous spray heads were observed and valves to be the cut off due to malfunction or persistent wetness. That's in March. Now, this was in January that they were told that. Now we're going over to March. Still hadn't addressed those problems that have been going on since 1998. So on January the 15th, the town reported a bypass of raw influent in an open channel due to high infiltration. In exceeding the capacity of the gravity line to the primary lagoon. Total records flow for that day exceeded 1.9 million gallons of sewage. Now they're permitted for 133 gallons a day, and then 1.9 million. They would need, I don't know how much spray field they would need to put 1.9 million gallons on. and 30,000 gallons at least into the southwest, into the wetlands in the southern part of the in southern, it says southwest of Primary Lagoon. So it's things that are constantly going wrong with the 100. And there's one other place right here that it says that in certain areas of the in certain areas there are places that are I'll put this up so you can see it. 35.9 inches in the monthly hydraulic load and limit in January. And it also goes in here says that currently about in some portions of the field is loaded at one half of the allowed loading. So you've got places that you're putting two and three times too much. You got places in the field that you're putting half as what you're permitted to put. The problem is not land. The problem is operating what they have got and taking care of the sewer lines that's in town to get rid of some of this infiltration. That's what I can see from this is not me. This is not Cecil Williams talking. This is Dina. Violations. That one of them is a notice of violation, 10 days intent to enforce. The other one is notice of violation and recommendation of enforcement action. So this is serious violations and stuff. So that being said, I would like the county commissioners today to vote against Elm City's land purchase in Nash County. And also my neighbors would like for the county commissioners to join us in opposing the increase in the Elm City spray fields until they fix the other sewer problems in their town. Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you. Okay, back to discussion. About giving them, yes.
Just to add to that, I think Mr. Williams did a great job of illustrating the need for additional spray field. This is the exact reason we need the additional capacity to disperse the wastewater more effectively to lessen the environmental impact. This is what the state's aware of our situation. The state has recommended additional spray field to help dilute the wastewater. And he did a great job of illustrating that need from the reports that the state's recently issued. But that is the base reasoning behind the need for the additional spray field. But just to take that into consideration, the state is aware of our situation. That's why we're currently under the moratorium, and their recommendation is additional spray field.
Okay, thank you. Back to the board's discussion. Do you want to give them more time to see if they can work with the community? Come up with a better solution?
Mr. Chair, I think for them to ever have a chance for it to pass, they're going to have to work out some more things.
Yeah. Well, I think so, too. And I would love to give them more time.
I'm not going to oppose them having some additional time to go back to the residents and have a discussion. You know, we should set some time limit on that.
Stick with it.
And when you set a time limit, stick with it. And if we come to the next point in the road and there's still not agreement, then I think we need to be prepared as a board to do what we were elected to do, make a decision.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we get some guidance, Mr. Chairman, from the manager, how much time he thinks that may take, in fairness, from Elm City's manager. Does he want a month? Does he want 2 months? Or what does he think he needs? And I'm agreeing with Mr. Outlaw that once that time expires, this board needs to take action.
Yeah.
Well, certainly.
I agree that it's going to come to a point that we're going to have
sure.
to take well, action, mean, but I'm in favor of giving them more time to work.
He's suggesting you ask them how much more time they need.
How much more time do you think you need? is it 30 days next commissioner's meeting?
We're just until the next scheduled meeting.
You think you can do it in 30 days?
We can push it to 60.
Would it facilitate that process if instead of meeting individually, you had a group?
Group meeting.
Meeting?
Yeah.
Because, you know, I kind of like to sit in on it myself and listen to what the full group's got to say.
Possibly 60 days?
No, I think you can certainly get a group together in 30 days. I wasn't recommending 60 or 90 days. I'm just saying, you know, that way when you got everybody at the table, you hear everybody's input. And it's not, I heard this, I thought I heard this, they might have said this. You hear it all at the same time, and everybody gets a chance to kind of have some dialogue back and forth when there's an issue placed on the table. And I think, you know, I'd really like to see some representation from Nash County at that meeting.
Mm-hmm. Well, you just mentioned that you would like to be there.
Well, but I'm not an expert in that area, and people that may have a better understanding of, because what I heard Mr. Williams say was, and again, I'm not an expert, but I heard Mr. Russell say that Diener says we need more land to fix all this stuff, and I heard Mr. Williams say, really, you just need to operate it better. So, mm-hmm. You know, we probably need somebody there that, you know, could talk to that as well.
You mean from Nash County?
If we got them, I mean, we got a guy. We got people that understand that kind of thing.
Well,
I mean, I'm willing to go in there with an open mind and listen, but.
Chairman, I make a motion we give them an extension for 60 days, just to be fair, and that Mr. Outlaw and our county engineer attend those meetings, Derek Hawks.
I second.
Your motion was how many days?
60 days.
50 days?
60.
60 days.
And to allow a September board meeting, whatever date that is.
Yeah. And that's something we're going to have to set today.
All right. Well, that's why I've changed it to the September board meeting, and let Mr. Outlaw and Mr. Hawks, who has a great knowledge of this, and then Mr. Hawks, if he needs more assistance from our own county engineer, they would be available.
Okay, that's a motion?
Yes, sir.
There a second?
I already had a second.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, motion. I'd also like to recommend that, you know, with that motion and that second, that we have an immediate process to notify the landowners.
Amen.
I don't want it to be, you know, 45, 50 days, and we got to go back and say, have you had these discussions? Have you notified everybody? Everybody needs to have plenty of time to prepare for the meeting, just like, you know, Elm City will have plenty of time to prepare for that meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So they need to be notified properly, and that needs to be documented.
Okay.
I don't know the best way to do that, but they just need to be notified. And it doesn't just need to be, Mr. Williams can give you, you've got his petition, you've got that information. If those people have expressed concerns, then I think we need to get those people's addresses, and we need to make them aware of the meeting, and they all need to be invited.
Mm-hmm. All right, the motion. And you agreed to include Commissioner Outlaw's concerns in the motion?
I have no problems with that.
Okay, all right.
Well, my thought, you know, to accomplish anything, you need to have people that are directly involved and not such a wide net. Okay. Do it gets more difficult to accomplish anything. I don't know the answer, Mr. Outlaw, to what that is, but if some of those signers of that petition are 10 miles away.
Mm-hmm. Well, certainly.
It's got to be some rim of reality.
I understand that.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be that Mr. Tyson Jr. and Mr. Tyson III and Mr. Williams are notified, and the onus is on them to go out and notify everybody else. They can do that, but I think we need to let the residents know more than 600 feet. Isn't that the current?
That's typically what we're doing in zoning. That's what we're
doing. Yeah. So if you go out to this particular area, in the immediate area, if you come on up the road and hook a right and go on up, there's some really pretty nice homes up in that area. And I think reasonably we need to reach out and get a little broader input from that area. I just can't imagine that, you know, those people are going to be happy with this.
All right, back to the motion. All in favor of that, excuse me, all in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign, ayes unanimous. Okay, 50 days and
60.
I'm sorry, 60 days.
September board meeting.
September board meeting. Okay, next on the agenda, sheriff's request.
Somebody left their cell phone here. Hmm. Okay. All right. Thank you for your time and consideration of the matter of moving our rank structure with the sheriff's office. I'll wait for that.
Whose cell phone was that, do we know?
He said it's his.
Oh. Oh, yeah, recording.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
They did. They did.
Okay.
Okay. Basically, I know when we brought it up last week, the realignment of the sheriff's office from the current rank structure, we're trying to bring it into more of a paramilitary rank structure that most law enforcement uses. The Highway Patrol uses this, and several other sheriff's offices, including Wake County. What we're trying to do is, from the chief deputy standpoint, by law, and in Nash County, it's supposed to be chief deputy. It's not supposed to be a major. However, he's got to have a rank as in a military structure. Below that, we've got the captains right now, which are running sections by military's rank and insignia. That should be a major's position because it's divisions and directors of those divisions. Up under that would be the captain rank, which is a lieutenant now. Lieutenants are supposed to be over platoons and not over command of different disciplines. Narcotics is one, patrols one, the jail is one. We're moving into that direction of putting a captain over each unit, where it'll be a unit commander. The lieutenant is over platoons. That will be in the detective division and also in the patrol division. Below that is the sergeant. He's supposed to be over a squad. And then the corporal, in the absence of him, was supposed to be over the squad. That's the rank structure where it is now. We want to bump up the structure from corporal to sergeant because the sergeant is the commander of the squad. It's not any money that's attached to this. I know that was some thought with the some of the board. However, there's no money. The last study that you did, it was did on the actual job that the member was doing or what he was responsible for. The responsibility is not changing. All it is the rank structure. And this is also going to enhance us where some of our members are not eligible for schools, some of those schools being FBI Academy, Southern Police Institute in Kentucky, the more prestigious schools for training, you've got to have at least a lieutenant rank to attend those schools. For us and development and moving people forward in the future, that will enhance us there where the rank will allow them to go to these schools. And last, if only you have a corporal working in the middle of the night, 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, he's dealing with other counties. These other counties have lieutenants that are the shift platoon leaders. The rank helps with correspondence between those others, but what it mainly is doing is just bringing it in line with other agencies. But there's no money attached to it. I know this last study, and we spoke with the lady that was doing the last study. Rank has nothing to do with it. What the only thing that the study was doing was what they were responsible for. Responsibilities are gonna stay the same.
Earl, is this your request to do this?
It is.
To meet your specification?
It is.
Okay, if that's time, I would put on the floor if I could make that. May have been the proper thing that would go ahead and.
Well, I was going to ask one question. How many majors
We have one major now, and what we would have then is two, because it'll be section directors. For instance, the jail, the courts, and civil will be under one discipline, and then patrol, narcotics will be under another discipline, and that will be the sections, the different sections. So you have a section director, which would have the major rank.
Okay. So you're talking about three majors, right?
No, it's going to be two majors. It'll be two majors. And those people that will be the majors would be Dennis Wooten and Pat Joyner. They're captains now. Only thing we're doing is moving them more in line with what the paramilitary uses or the Marine Corps' rank structure.
Is this your request, Chair?
And they remain with the same classification, grade.
Same pay, yes. Yeah, same. Grade won't change. It's not changing anything with that. All we do is changing the rank.
Mm-hmm. But excuse me, Sheriff, would this not also help them as they attend classes going somewhere else that you need to be, maybe the lieutenant would go to a different class, the captain would go to a different, all come together?
Sure it does. But and it also another thing that it does is the retention of our employees and development, sending them, if they are applying for a chief's position somewhere, my mentality is any of my men that want to better themselves and go somewhere else, I want to help them. Obviously, a lot of agencies will say you've got to have a certain rank to be able to apply for this position. It enables them to do that. And another thing that we are going to implement is from corporal to sergeant, before they can ever make that rank, they have got to attend schools for supervision. Where we don't have that now, you know, it's going to be a self-fulfillment. You've got to obtain these schools before you're eligible for promotion. Just trying to put professionalism in office.
Which makes them better Nash County employees.
Sure.
I move your request.
Mr. Chairman, I still have a question. If Mr. Morgan,
we have more questions, Commissioner Morgan. So we'll wait on your motion and let all the questions be.
We know who wants to make the motion, Mr. Morgan. Give us just a second here.
Just hold it a minute.
Keith, you mentioned Wake County does it this way. Would you talk about our other surrounding counties where they're at, the Halifax and Northampton, Warren, Johnson, Wilson?
I would think that Johnston County and probably Halifax would be too.
Halifax is not like you're asking it to be.
How is theirs? They've got a lieutenant running their platoons.
I know the major is the second one in Bruce is considered a major.
Right. Okay, when they have lieutenants running their their platoons.
They're like we are now, almost, except for
the lieutenant's position.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And in all actuality, it shouldn't be a major anyway. It should be a chief deputy. By law, it should never even be used as a major's position. And the rank should be at a colonel for the rank structure of the chief deputy, because in the absence of the sheriff, he is the commander.
So the one thing y'all are after, apparently, is to allow more of our people to be trained in certain schools. Is that what's driving the whole thing?
The main two things is for certain schools and development of the employees. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if they want to put in for an application to go somewhere else, that they meet that rank is secondary. But primary is so that I can get some of our people that have not made the rank of lieutenant, and that I cannot send them to Southern Police Institute or send them to the FBI Academy. It's for development of our people in our office. Because if you look right now, most of our men that's got the rank of major, which will be our new major's position, they got 15 to maybe a year left is one of them, and then the other one is actively looking for chief's positions. I need, for retention of my office, to be able to have these people already trained up, ready to go, if somebody steps out, for them to move in, succession planning.
Well, you know what I'm nervous about. I just...
The money, I understand.
Believe that we somewhere in here it's not going to cost us something.
It's not costing anything. Matter of fact, the rank, the grade will be adjusted to what that rank is. We don't go, you know, that has nothing to do with the duties of what they're doing. And your last pay study was based on duties performed. They will still do the duties they perform, just have a different rank structure.
Z, in your opinion, with our pay study we did, the way she looked at it, and I know you learned very well how she looked at it, because part of it she didn't particularly like, this wouldn't have affected that pay study at all?
Not,
I haven't had a conversation with her about this particular issue,
but I think it's true that she was driven by actual job duties that got discussed with each individual employee, as the sheriff said.
Right, and so based upon his representations, based upon what I understand the pay study was to look at, if the grade isn't changing for a position, just the title, it should not affect the pay. Whether in a future study it may affect it, I don't believe so, but right. That was my first inclination as far as having a fear, but I've been assured that it wouldn't affect any future pay study either. When they compare this jurisdiction with other jurisdiction, it won't be based upon their title. It'll be based upon their duties.
Sure, but each grade has a minimum and a max.
That is correct.
Right. Yeah. In your study in this, in your staff study, did you turn up any reason why you a negative to doing this at all?
Yes, sir. The one negative, the minor negative, is the rank insignia is going to cost probably $100 to $200 changing the rank on the guys. Other than that, no, I think that will be an enhancement, because when our officers on critical incidents are dealing with another agency somewhere, I think they can get things done a little bit quicker when their commissioned officers asking rather than non-commissioned officers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right.
I'm Commissioner Morgan. Still got it.
Commissioner Morgan is moving that we accept the sheriff's request.
Second.
Seconded by, I saw Commissioner Wells.
Ms. Wells will be for great.
Yeah. Commissioner Wells, second the motion.
It doesn't make any difference to me as long as they get it.
You've heard the motion. Any more discussion?
I just want to say I wake up every morning and I worry about a lot of things. The schools and a lot of other things. But you know what worries me most? The fact that I can get out and get in my car and get from Westmount to Nashville safely. And these guys make that possible.
Amen. Amen.
So I thank you for what you do.
Thank you. We got a good service.
And I trust and support the sheriff in what he's trying to do to improve law enforcement in Nash County.
Thank you.
Amen.
All right. Back to the motion. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Ayes unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Chairman. Commissioners, thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda, high-speed internet update. Patson.
Per the request of Commissioner Outlaw and Commissioner Barnes, we'd like to take this opportunity to update the board a little bit regarding the efforts of the Nash County High Speed Internet Implementation Team. Back in April 2014, you may recall, we began working with Jason Simple of the North Carolina Department of Commerce Office of Digital Infrastructure. He was sort of our unpaid consultant on the strategic initiative to expand high-speed internet in Nash County. And we want to thank him tremendously for his guidance. He's not here today because he's actually moving on to take on another responsibility, but we appreciate his help during the time that he helped Nash County. It's been a delight also to work with the high-speed internet implementation team, which includes two of our county commissioners, Commissioner Outlaw and Commissioner Barnes. It also includes three citizens who we have termed community champions: Hattie Cooper of Castalia area, Carl Holland of Aventon, and Cephas Ray of the Bailey area. And we also want to recognize the staff who have participated on this team, from administration to emergency services to our GIS coordinator, our MIS department, and planning. The high-speed internet implementation team has a keen interest, all of us do, in expanding the availability of high-speed internet throughout the county to as much area as possible in the shortest amount of time and at the least cost possible. Let me just review a little bit about our efforts in the last few years. I've worked here for a little over 12 years, and during much of that time, we've been trying to solve this problem of unserved and underserved residents. We don't get too many complaints from the Rocky Mount and Nashville areas, but in many other areas of the county, citizens have expressed a great deal of frustration. High-speed internet is important to them and you, and of course us. As you well know, high-speed internet is important for education, economic development, and quality of life, whether it's for e-books for our school children, online classes for high school, college, and continuing education students, ordering Christmas presents online, using the square for PTO concession sales, watching videos for education or entertainment, playing games, checking Facebook, or operating a business, farm, government, or any other type of traditional or non-traditional business or industry. We would like for our citizens, of course, to be 100% served with high-speed internet. We can't own or operate a system, nor do we have that desire. What we can do is partnership with others to try to expand the service to as much of the county as we can. For at least 15 years, Nash County has been meeting with one of our primary providers, Sprint, which became Embark and then CenturyLink, about expanding service. And we understand from many of these discussions how important the infrastructure cost, density, and the payback period are to businesses that provide high-speed internet service. We're interested in both fiber solutions, which are generally more costly, and wireless solutions. We tried in 2010 to partner with the town of Red Oak, which at the time as a municipality could own and operate infrastructure, but we were unsuccessful in obtaining a federal USDA stimulus grant. In 2011, the legislature approved, let's see, somehow Rosemary, this isn't coming up there.
Oh, it's because I've got the computer off.
Yeah, we'll need that a little bit later. In 2011, the legislature approved House Bill 593, and it says Nash County can provide grants to incent providers to deploy high-speed internet in public-private partnerships for economic development purposes. And this was later expanded to cover all the counties in North Carolina during that same session. And we want to really thank the efforts of our representatives, Representative Collins, Representative Richardson, and also Senators Newton and Bryant for their efforts in this regard. However, there are many areas of Nash County, as you well know, where there is a lack of high-speed internet and also a lack of economic development opportunities. So we've had a little bit of a difficulty taking advantage of this legislation to date. A few years back, the MCNC, which is a nonprofit internet provider in the Research Triangle Park, they provided the middle mile using some USDA funds and Golden Leaf funds. And this mostly serves hospitals, emergency operation centers, and schools, public schools. And our group is trying to go beyond this middle mile to what's called the last mile in service areas where it's lacking. We want to encourage private providers to expand the service. One thing that Jason encouraged us to do is to identify demand. So we went about this in several different ways based on some things he had done in other communities. We had petitions, such as this one. They were distributed in many locations, including stores, libraries, municipalities, restaurants, and our community champions, who again were the private citizens who think this issue is so important that they would volunteer their time to help us identify the demand. They went into their communities, churches, Ruertan clubs, PTOs, etc., and gathered signatures and addresses of people who thought that the internet at either their home or their business did not meet the demands that they had for their family or their business. We appreciate the coverage by the local newspapers that have followed our efforts. We also, that helped increase the number of people who would either sign the petitions or go at the time to www.ncbroadband.gov and report a lack of service. We also had a code red notice that went out to people in Nash County in September of 2014, and that resulted in 60 hits right away. Now that the state is no longer providing, to my understanding, that link, so that's no longer available. But during the course of our study, it benefited us greatly. In December of 2015, Nash Rocky Mount Public Schools partnered with us to provide surveys, which they sent home with all their school children. And we, you can see here the results of the surveys. And this is the second page, which has most of the questions, so I'm gonna put that there. And this is based on one that had been used in other counties by the state as well. With all the surveys that were received, 3,574 were returned to us with useful information that basically the family or the student would say that the internet coverage they have is either not reliable, is not at a reasonable cost, or the speed of the connection is less than they need in their home. Another thing that we've done, and Rosemary, will you pull up the map? Is develop an asset map that includes public, semi-public, and private structures that can be leveraged to deploy high-speed internet infrastructure. And what the map shows, and I realize it's small and we have a bigger copy, but we can zoom in on it if you want to see different sections. But this map you have in front of us has the assets that are available to internet providers that are publicly owned or semi-public that they might be able to use to expand infrastructure. And it also has the demand, the blue dots from the petitions and the yellow dots from the school surveys. I also wanted to recognize the efforts, I forgot to do so, of Jane Tyson in the Sandy Cross community, who certainly did due diligence in gathering petitions in that area. We met on May 20th with several providers. These included NC Wireless, CenturyLink, Suddenlink, and the NC Office of Digital Infrastructure, a company called CloudWise, and a company, WRCNC, and we subsequently provided information as well to Time Warner Cable, detailed information to all of these in a digital format. But we met on May 20th, and since then, we have met with a provider at their request. They requested an interest from us, and we are working now, hopefully. on some details that might lead to a partnership, and we may be able to come back to you sometime in the near future to ask for your support on that partnership. We've been asked not to reveal many details at this time publicly, but it it would involve wireless technology in several areas of the county where we've had significant interest. And the technology would be such that if you could, from your home or business, see the tower that was providing the infrastructure, then you could be served. So I'm sure you may have questions, and I can try to answer them, as well as Commissioner Outlaw and Commissioner Barnes might be able to answer them as
well.
Might
want to clarify the tower. It doesn't have to be a traditional tower. It could be any structure that was high enough to get the signal from it.
Correct. That could be a variable height, some not very high at all, really, just above the trees.
Yes. Could be water towers or, you know, water tanks, anything above the trees.
Figure out what the cost would be for the consumer, what kind of equipment they would need.
Well, in the one company that we've met with thus far, the cost would be significantly reduced from some of the existing providers, and we're unsure. There probably would be some infrastructure within the home to connect to the tower.
Okay. Any comments or any questions? Well, we don't need to try to take any action. Just want to thank the two commissioners, Commissioner Barnes and Commissioner Outlaw, and our staff member, Patsy McGee. I know I had a conflict that y'all met, and I couldn't come and get to the meeting, but it sounds like you're working on something that's going to be helpful. And we want to thank you for what you've done.
Can you kind of share from here where we go, what the plans are in order to continue advancing this process?
Yes, we have provided some information to that company that's interested, and they are contacting some of our contacts and some other providers that they might subcontract some of their work to. But we plan to also meet with the municipalities when we get a little bit further in this process. There may be some opportunities not only for the county and, say, the community college to benefit from this, but also our municipalities. And so without revealing too much, I hesitate to do that since the company asked me not to, but we do have plans in the near future to provide more information and to include others in this process.
Thank you. That's good.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Next on the agenda is renewal of franchise agreement. Call on Brian. It's time.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Just a second. Request renewal of the franchise agreements with the three current ambulance providers. That's North State Medical Transport, Eastern Medical, and K&L Transport. This is the first approval. I'll be back in August for the second approval. And each of these services assist us when we're busy, and they can handle some transports for us. And they come in as our supervisor or assistant requests them to come in when our service is real busy. And they need a franchise agreement for that purpose, and they understand that agreement. So I ask this board to approve these franchise agreements. And again, I'll be back in August for the second approval.
Any questions? If not, ready for a motion to approve the request.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Wells.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Morgan. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Ayes unanimous.
Thank you.
Agenda call for another 10-minute break, but do you need it? If not, let's move on, all right? I'll say let's move on.
What do you say, another 10-minute break?
I said the agenda calls for another 10-minute break.
You need a break. For a break, we need it then. That'd be great.
Okay, Commissioner Morgan said you need it. Let's make it 5 this time. Okay, 5-minute break.
How you doing?
Good.
As we
you been getting many things?
In terms of what we're going to do, what I'm going to do is just take a look at the map and go out and see where some clusters of housing. It's going to be a different distance in any direction.
I don't know that it really that it matters, you know, for Wilson County. I mean, we're just kind of dealing with Nash County.
Chart them.
Yeah, I didn't talk to
my thought was, right, my thought was to give Jonathan in Elm City the Wilson County group. This is what
right.
We have.
And give us the criteria that you're using.
And what'll happen is when sometime in the next few days, I'm going to get a call from Jasper Tyson, and he's going to know what occurred today.
Right.
And I'm going to tell him that Elm City is going to make a contact with a broader spectrum of people. And that if you want to ensure that that takes place, then by word of mouth, you should get it out. And I'm going to tell Ms. Griffin that over in Wilson County.
Well, I told two ladies in the
park. They don't run it because
they're
mismanaging.
But they're mismanaging.
That's Ms. Griffin's
group. So, anyway.
The lady that heads up the community watch over in that area, Homestead Road.
And she's on the Wilson County side, but I told her I would send her whatever we send out in Nash County, so I certainly sent her a copy because I told her I would. But
I just be careful.
Well, Mr. Ellis,
right.
Yeah.
What are the criteria you use?
And like when we sent it out last time, we put the notice of the meeting on one side, and we put a map on the other side, the same sheet of paper that had a location in front.
What's your other name?
What we might do on this one is I may send
if you don't show up, she's
at least a couple of people, you know, send us out the show area that we notified within that
one.
She also mentioned that, mobile home park across the
you want me to go?
I said, well, that's in Wilson County. She said, understand, appreciate what you said. You know, we two things to remember. One is, that's going to be, Elm City. And they said they would do that. They said that was funny. I said, but you have to remember about
and maybe that
about a manufactured home park. Notice
they all the property owner, not to the individual. Then that's why it was done.
Yeah.
So you see, if you could, it might help, but I don't know. But I'm going tonight anyway. So. She went this morning. She said when the board elections are open, she's going to file for the election. So I guess he'll be stepping in behind. Oh,
but Queen.
They're just too mean, evil folks.
When they talk to me, I'm sure they're by word of mouth going to get the word out there. I don't think she would. But I'm going to talk to Derek, and I'm going to ask Derek to look at the Dena reports and to make some review of that and tell me what his opinions are, because it sounded like to me, and you know much more about this than I do, you probably should be on this group.
Tom Betts.
Sounds like maybe just not operating it as efficiently and properly as they could or should.
What he got two problems, they're not operating, but he got a lot of infiltration system, and it's very expensive to fix that. That's the reason. He got leaking lines throughout the county, throughout the city. They fix all that, probably would need to. Sometimes the extensions are cheaper to fix, they don't have to go there. But that's what I would do, whatever criteria you use.
I sent you an email.
It was bad, man. It hurt so bad. I couldn't even walk.
Calls back into session. Finance matters. Then call on Donna.
Okay, the first item I have is I have budget amendments for the board's consideration. I have three grant amendments. The first one is with the health department for $20,000. This is to enhance public health emergency preparedness planning and operation readiness for Ebola virus disease. The second one is for the health department, $3,000. It's a one-year grant from Vidant Edgecombe Hospital Community Benefit. It's a Vidant Edgecombe Hospital Community Benefits Grant and Health Initiative Program to support living healthy with diabetes. And that's $3,000. And the third item is an EMS grant. It's a Duke Endowment grant awarded to provide a community paramedic, program. And none of these require county funds.
Okay, any questions? Well, if not.
It's a need there, isn't it? It's a need for all the grants, isn't it?
Yes, there is.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right, that's my question.
Yeah, and especially that Ebola virus, these need to be prepared for it. You never know when it may strike. No questions? Then I call for a motion to approve the budget amendments.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Morgan.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Barnes. You've heard that motion. All in favor of it? Let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed at the same sign. Unanimous. Approval.
Okay.
Capital project.
The next item I have on the agenda is to approve the capital project ordinance for the Nashville EMS station. This is to set up the actual project. And what the funds have already been appropriated into. The funds have already been appropriated, but we'll use the fund balance within that fund. And we're setting up for administrative cost, architectural engineering, equipment supply, construction, and a contingency line item.
Okay.
Setting up the capital project for $500,000.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, we actually have $550,000 in reserve. We're gonna hold 50 of it in reserve just in case we need it, but we're hoping and we expect the project to get in under $500,000.
Are you gonna hold that in reserve, is that right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Question, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Do you happen to remember or Vince that law? We're doing this as informal. Does it say under 500,000 or 500 and under?
I thought it was 800,000.
No, 500.
It's 500.
But I'm not sure. If I can't tell the number.
my thought is, I have been questioned about it by an individual concerned about it. And if we should remove a dollar from this, I'd like to do it just to make it under, if that's what it says, rather than 500,000. prior to approving the funds. Maybe take a dollar out of contingency, but I'm not sure how the general statute reads.
Well, this is going to only apply to the construction contract anyway, the 430, unless it includes a contingency.
It would include the contingency.
Mm-hmm. 460, so you ought to be good.
And it does include architectural and engineering and administration. I'm not sure about the equipment part of it.
Well, I'm not either. Or administration, so that ought to get you. That ought to get you under the 500.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, it would be for the bidding of the are you talking about the informal bidding? That would be for the construction, and I think that's what he was specifically. But I don't think it's the entire project.
Well, it's not the entire project, but they sent me the general statute, and I didn't bring it with me today when they questioned me about it.
Is this a contractor or a...
No, sir.
Or a architect?
The latter.
Okay. We could make the contingency say $25,000 and make it a $495,000 project.
It'd be knocking out of five.
Out of contingency. Mm-hmm. Or a thousand, or, you know, but
yeah.
Either one, whatever your motion would call.
And then if you need the whole 30, then you got to do what, a budget amendment?
Yes, sir.
Well, I think we're good, like, with the equipment, because that's really, that's not part of construction. But just to play it safe, we can take out 1,000 or 5,000 out of contingency and adopt the ordinance accordingly.
Let's take the 1,000 out and adopt the ordinance. Keep it under 500,000.
You want to change the contingency to 29,000? Okay.
So we need a motion?
Yes, we do.
Statute says that bids are required for 500,000 or more. Formal bidding is, so it's 499,999.
Right, gotcha. That's what I thought I remembered. Are we doing this as an individual item? Yes. Mr. Chairman, I'd make a motion. We make one small change on this capital project ordinance by changing the contingency to 29,000 in lieu of 30, and move for approval on the revised total of 499,000.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Davis and second by Commissioner Bond that we take $1,000 out of the contingency fund part of it and approve the capital project for $499,000. You've heard that motion. Any more discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Pass unanimous. Next, board appointments.
The first item we have is jury commission appointment. We do this every 2 years. One person is up for reappointment. It's Ms. Bobby May. We've been requested by the clerk of court to request her reappointment, which would be for another 2-year term expiring on June 30th, 2017.
Moved request.
Second. Moved by Commissioner Davis and second by Commissioner Richardson that we reappoint Bobby May as what was that? Jury commission. Jury commission. Mm-hmm. You've heard that motion. All in favor of it, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Motion passed unanimous.
And the second item is an appointment to the Tourism Development Authority. As you know, Mr. David Joyner has resigned from the TDA as of last month. His unexpired term needs to be filled with another qualified person, which is a collector member, and the term will expire on April 30th, 2016.
At this point, I have not identified that person. I again solicit the board's help. It does need to be someone that works at one of our hotels or owns one of them. And Mr. Chairman, this was one of my minority members, and I'd really like to replace it with a minority member, if at all possible. So that's
and
kind
that
of the thing.
Classification is?
They must be a collector, which means they've got to work for the hotel or either be an owner of a hotel. And that seat currently is vacant because Mr. Joyner resigned immediately.
Well, I have no recommendations at this meeting, but I work with you.
Okay. It's a little bit of a challenge to find out, you know, it's got to be fit both. It's got to fit the collector status.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. And lastly, just in case anyone had anybody, we still have the two vacancies on the Consolidated Human Services Board for the psychiatrist member and the psychologist member.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Hill, leave. Yeah, they're having their first formal meeting this month. And I will ask Mr. Hill to try to get his board to look for some members to fill those two spots.
That's hard. Not only is hard to fill.
It is.
Yeah. Ms. Dorsey, the name you gave me previously, I did talk to, and she is not a psychologist. She actually has a social worker's degree,
okay.
Even though she does what you did do, which is, I don't think that qualified her.
She was counseling, but she wasn't the full psychologist.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, we'll move on then. We'll put that one on for next month again.
Okay.
And the next thing I have is some discussion about the September meeting date. As you know, we had changed the meeting date to the 14th. Because of the Labor Day holiday. Since then, Commissioner Barnes has indicated or been accepted into the Advanced Leadership Corps program, and she's gonna be out of place from the 13th to the 18th.
That's right.
Ms. Richardson noted that she will be out of place from September 2nd to the 8th. So wanted to see if the board could find a date that could accommodate all the members being at our meeting. And I'm looking maybe between the two, the 9th or 10th, which is not a Monday.
Ms. Dawson.
Well,
yes. Ms. Dawson. Yeah. I'm sorry, that's a correction. And it might have been my error. I'll be out of town the 2nd through the 9th.
Through the
9th? Not the 8th.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. That's okay. Well, we just need to know.
Well, how's the 10th? September 10th, which is on Thursday.
Yep.
Need that day. I want a birthday cake.
I like to schedule that this one. Meeting. Up
that will put it between
front,
the two
as much as possible at the front of the month rather than way down, because otherwise we got to go down in the 20s.
Right, the 10th or the 11th would be open, the Thursday or the Friday.
Mm-hmm. I personally like the 10th.
Mm-hmm.
But
where were we at, like the 1st of September, the 2nd of September, was there a problem there with someone?
She's going to be gone from the 2nd.
No, yeah, but the 1st is okay.
The first is okay.
I leave on the 2nd.
Oh, the first day?
Tuesday. First day, the Tuesday.
What's the first?
Well, then?
Tuesday.
September 1 is a Tuesday?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I have a meeting at 3 o'clock on the 1st, but I just hope we be out of here so I can get to it.
Well, that would be up to the discretion of the chairman, sir.
Well, I can move it along now. I don't want to hear no look at you. You're not allowing people to say this or do this or say that. But I do have every first Tuesday of every month, I have a 3 o'clock meeting that I must attend.
Staff would be fine with September 1 or the 10th. Either one's fine.
I'm available either one.
I'll go with September 1.
Okay.
I'm gonna move you out of it. We're gonna get out no later than 2. I'm talking about the meeting and closed session by at least 2 o'clock.
Do you want to start earlier than 10?
10 o'clock is fine.
Okay.
May we start about 6 a.m. that morning, Mr. Chairman? May we start about 6 o'clock that morning? I'm just kidding.
We start early.
Well, do y'all want to come in at 9:30?
9 o'clock, fine.
At 9 o'clock, suit me.
Whatever.
Okay.
Okay, well.
Which one?
I go with 9 o'clock.
All right.
9.
That gives you another hour and a half.
What about it, Ken?
Janice, just give us good reminder, sure.
Probably need a motion, Mr. Chairman, on that one.
Yeah, I'm writing it down now.
Okay.
And I'm going to call for a motion to approve.
Tuesday the 1st or September the, or Thursday the 10th?
Tuesday the 1st, 9 o'clock.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Moved by Commissioner Davis.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Richardson. You heard that motion. All in favor of that date, September 1. Let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. It passed unanimous. So we'll see you September 1. 9 o'clock. Okay, tax report.
Mr. Chairman, of course, the first item is no action required on. I'll be glad to answer any questions you might have, and also about the second item, which would require your approval, being the refund request.
And of course, on the tax report, not any questions on the refund. Motion to approve the refund.
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Richardson.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Barnes. All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Motion passed unanimous.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, the next thing on the agenda is any reports coming from commissioners?
Well, I will mention that I got word from Mayor Lewis that his board did approve going forward with the senior center, or with the memo.
Yeah, at the park.
Right.
Senior center at the park.
I haven't heard from Mayor Johnson yet, but I did hear from Mayor Lewis.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
What senior center citizen are you referring? What place are you referring
to? Senior center over at Middlesex Bailey Park.
At the Middlesex and Bailey Park.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I have to say is that we have a lot of things happening with our school system, and I plan to attend their board meeting tonight as a citizen, not representing the commissioners.
May I ask you one more question, then I'm just you going me on this. What about the senior centers at the parks? You gonna have a senior citizen there?
The senior center building.
Center building.
Right, the building for the southern part of the county.
And the senior citizen will be at the park.
Mm-hmm. That's where they'll have their activities.
I'll vote no on that one. Go ahead.
Okay, County Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple things. Spring Hope tonight is going to consider our Parks and Rec agreement. I think Vince has, after several revisions, has got it in a way that their staff supports. Basically, that is the agreement that, in a nutshell, that we will repair those restrooms. They will, beginning this year, provide $7,000 per year to offset that cost, as well as future capital needs. So
Hopefully that will be approved tonight, and we will bring that to you at the next meeting for your concurrence. Also, Whitaker's, I think I've given y'all an update on that before. We discovered that the library did not have its proper nonprofit status, and we had requested certain information. It continues. We made a recommendation that the library board turn over and deed over to the town of Whitaker's that property, and because generally governments give money to nonprofits and other governments, city governments. So we could justify doing it like we do in Bailey and Spring Hope and other towns, but there is some resistance apparently by the current board of trustees of the library. Ms. Richardson, Commissioner Richardson's going to attend again tonight, that meeting, and for that discussion. To supplement Mr. Wren's information, I'm pleased to report that with 1 month of vehicles not yet reporting, the county tax collection is 98.35. It might go up another hundredth or two hundredths of a point, but it's 98.35 right now compared to 97.73 last year and 95.51 the year before. Part of that is, a big part of that is the new vehicle tax collection system, but also each of the last 2 years, the tax office has increased collections for real property as well as personal property. So just congratulations to his department, and just job well done. Finally, I just want to reiterate something that the board did at the last meeting that I haven't read an article about that I thought was really really big that the commissioners did, and that is that they appropriated another $750,000 for the courthouse project. They had already appropriated $1.25 million, so now there is in reserve $2 million for the courthouse project. That doesn't mean we won't need to do some financing to complete the project, but it does reduce the amount of financing that will be necessary, as well as interest payments that will be necessary. With the commissioners also set aside $250,000 for a county recreation in the Cooper's area project, and staff's hard at work trying to locate a location for that. $250,000 in addition also was appropriated from fund balance for the senior center that Commissioner Barnes mentioned in Middlesex, Bailey area at the park down there. And the idea, Mr. Morgan, is that they're going to build a senior center that later can be added on to when the long-range plan for the community park down there is fulfilled, having a community building. So it'll be connected to the senior center. But we're not going to wait for that to happen. I think that's phase three or four of their project. The commissioners feel like we need to move forward with providing a senior center for the southern part of the county. And so they, at the last meeting, appropriated $250,000 to begin that process. And finally, the commissioners appropriated $500,000 for economic development. That is a shell building. I think the county's had a lot of success in shell buildings in the past. The Nut Cow business that moved from Italy here, was a shell building that the county was able to sell and recoup its money and bring jobs and a new industry to the county. So got a total of $1.75 million that the county commissioners at the last meeting appropriated on projects that there's been a lot of discussion about, but that there had been no funds appropriated for, but now there have been. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Thank you. We got one more thing before that I asked the staff to prepare, is a resolution in supporting the transportation bond referendum. It's a statewide bond referendum. Of course, the governor wants it to be on the fall ballot during municipal elections. But we are saying it in this resolution that we put together here, that staff put together at my request, that if the General Assembly does not approve the cost of the elections during November, then we support the referendum being on the presidential primary in March. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman, as you and I discussed, I'm in favor of supporting this referendum of the governor's, but I'm not in favor of asking for it to be at a November election. Reason being that's going to be for municipal elections only. It would be a very low turnout, I think, and it would be in the counties. It would be a significant turnout in those areas that have municipal elections, but it certainly wouldn't be in all of them. I just feel like when we are doing the right thing by having a bond referendum to do major capital projects, whether it's on a county level or on a state level, this one being a state level, we should take that vote at a time when we expect the most voters to participate. And that closest time is not that far away. It would be in March at our expected presidential primary. And I'd like to see us change the resolution to have it at that date. Plus, that date, all precincts will be open throughout the state, and it would save approximately $8 million. I realize the governor has said that he would pay for the county's cost out of the bond proceeds, but that's still $8 million that comes from the taxpayers that could be used for the projects instead of paying for having what I deem a special election to have the bond referendum. So I would hope that we would consider just passing a resolution even without a date given for the proposed vote, but expect it to be held at the March primary. And if I need to explain that, yeah, I know.
I would like to see you explain it, Robbie. Tell me okay. Which time are they going to pay and which time are they not going to pay?
All right. Mr. Morgan, what would happen if we were to do it in November? We would have to open up all precincts throughout the state. And understand the only voting going on that day is the municipal elections in some areas, certainly not all areas. So therefore, there would be an $8 million cost to have a statewide elections, including all precincts. If we were to do it in March at our presidential primary, all precincts are open anyway. Therefore, there would be no additional cost at all to the state or to local counties because we're having that general election anyway, and it's 5 months difference in the two.
And in all the precincts
4 months
that were not in a municipality, then the only thing on the ballot would be the referendum, correct? Mm-hmm.
Right. Say that again now.
In November.
In November, if you had a precinct open that was not in a, representing a municipality, the only item on the ballot would be that, referendum. So what are the chances are that people are going to come out just to vote on that referendum? They're probably not. And so we, the state would have spent $8 million. Well, the governor says he's going to pay for it, but the problem with that is the governor doesn't have any money. The state taxpayers provide the money. So you've got no additional cost if you do this in March.
Mr. Chairman, just for clarification purposes, there are 27 precincts in Nash County. I've been told that 7 of them would be utilized in the November municipal elections. So that would leave 20 that otherwise would not open, that we would have this single matter on the ballot.
Well, the way the referendum is stated, even though it says November election, it doesn't put in a specific date, or even in March, not in a specific date. And because the governor is pushing it strong to have it, but so far the legislators have not given him any indication that that's what they're going to do.
Mr. Chairman, I also obtained a list of all counties through Disconnect Inc. that had currently passed a resolution. There are currently 22 of them that have passed, and my understanding, I don't have a copy of all of them, but in talking to the person that's handling this for the governor, there's only 2 of those 22 that have included a November date. The rest of them either used a March date, but by far the majority, 18 of them, have used a resolution like Martin County or Johnson County, or some of the rest of them around us, which I've got some copies of, where they just did not put a date in there. And I think it's going to increase the likelihood of our legislators going along with it if we don't tie it down to that November, because there's a lot of opposition about the November date and it being at a time when you would have the fewest number of voters and more than likely only voters located within a town or municipality. I've got some a Johnson County resolution and a Martin County resolution here that is what I hope we would consider. But that's Commissioner Seven talking, sir.
Mr. Chairman, if he's got an alternative,
Basically,
we could change yours.
Well, all you have to do to the one we got here, if that's the approval of the majority on the board, is just take out November.
Well, you got several things you need to take out.
Like what?
Well,
the part about the March.
The part about March.
Because it says in the agenda.
I thought that's what we were saying, Joe was saying you wanted during the presidential primary.
Well, what I'm saying is I would prefer us to adopt it without a date at all, which is what the majority of the people are doing. May I hand this to the manager, Mr. Chairman?
Or if we could get it up on the screen so everybody can see it.
Yeah, put it on the screen.
Okay. This is one from Johnson County.
This is what you
What's your Nash County going to be, you know?
Well, I don't know till we vote, Mr. Morgan.
But he may not want to say specifically a date.
This one is pretty short. Can you move that sticker? There you go.
I can't tell what it is in there.
This has no date. This has no date.
We just changed one word, really, which is Nash for Johnston.
All right. I'd like to know how many board members want to take out the dates.
I'm not sure what you're asking.
That's out of the resolution.
I think he's saying we support the resolution, but not for it to be in November.
I would suggest that we support the resolution currently shown on the screen, so we understand what we're saying.
Well, all we got to do is just, I still say go back to what we have here. All we got to do, if this is the feelings of the majority on the board, take out where it says November election and also the presidential preference primary. We could just.
Paragraph in front, this is easier to adopt that.
Mr. Chairman, the resolution on the screen is pretty clear, and it already does accomplish what you just said.
Just putting hash on it.
It's not time specific. It's not time specific. It doesn't give a certain date to hold the election. It just says we support the effort.
Mm-hmm. What is wrong with the existing ones that we're using now? What are they? Are the time element hindrance? Paying forward or what?
Yes, yeah, that's supposed to go.
When it would be held, November versus March.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is it just, it says we support it, but we don't.
Okay.
You like it?
I'm ready. I'm ready to act on it. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, for simplicity, I'd make Lou, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I'm just making sure I phrased it right. I would make the motion that we approve the sample one that we are.
Resolution.
The resolution. That Johnson County did, that we are doing the same. How do you phrase that? I'm looking at the one on the screen.
Yeah, that one. Mm-hmm. Johnson.
Okay. I move that we adopt the resolution that is shown on the screen, that Nash.
Change
the date on that. Okay. I'm making sure I phrase it right.
Is there a second?
Ms. Barnes, second.
Second by Commissioner Barnes. All in favor of the motion to adopt the resolution that's on the screen, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposes the same sign. Aye. Motion passed 6-1. And that is, we have adopted supporting the bond referendum with no date.
Let me ask you one more question, why you've already done it by this. They are not gonna pay the money that they would pay if we went to another time, is that what we're saying?
Commissioner Morgan, is my understanding that if it's held this coming November during the municipal election, that the governor has said that the state would pay for it. Now, I know Commissioner Davis said it would come out of the bond money. I haven't heard him say that, but whatever. They said they would pay for it.
It doesn't matter where it comes from. The fact is, they don't have any money. All the money comes from the taxpayers.
Yeah.
And so if you do it at another date when you've got your polls open anyway, then there's no additional cost. I mean.
All right. And that means that most likely, what I'm hearing is that it will be put on the ballot during the presidential primary, which is in March. I'm not sure what date in March, I haven't heard, but it will be in March.
Okay.
So it's going to be on the ballot. The question is when, and most people are favoring doing the presidential primary.
And to clarify your comment, Mr. Morgan, if it's in March, the state will not pay for it, but we've already been obligated by legislation to hold elections at the county level.
Right.
So,
I mean, the election is going to be going on whether it's on or whether it ain't. There is no additional cost.
And under our ballot system, it will be on the same piece of paper, so it's no additional cost.
Okay.
But the county will be paying for that election unless they appropriate money otherwise.
Hey, could you email us a copy of that once it's, you know, you change the Johnson to Nash?
Yes.
Just so we'll have it.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Okay. All right. Next thing on the agenda is closed session.
I move to closed session.
Moved by Commissioner Barnes and seconded by Commissioner Wells, that we go into closed session. Economic development matters and personnel matters.
Oh, you got personnel on. Okay, never mind.
All in favor of that motion, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed, same sign. Motion passed unanimous. I don't anticipate nothing, no action after after coming out of this.
The
meeting.
Said, where is he going to get the
money from?
Don't say
where you're
going to
get
it.
Where everything comes from.
I mean, you know, that's
yeah.
Understanding.
Oh,
yeah.
For the main thing, Lou, you need to have most people like
this. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking about that more than they clean up.
Oh, yeah. Like you said, they'll come out with that big one, the little one.
So it's not going to take